Good morning.
Now, that was much better.
All right, before I begin in the lesson this morning, I have a proud father moment that I have to share with everybody. So we were sitting there last night, and we were going through our Bible class that we usually do every night. Jackie usually does the Bible curriculum with them. And then when it's my turn, usually what I'll do is we'll just sing songs and we'll just talk about something. And the girls will tell me, I want to talk about making friends or something like that. We'll see what the Bible has to say about making friends. And so last night we were going through our Bible class and we're sitting around the kitchen table. And after Jackie finished up with the Bible time with the girls started giggling. And I'm sitting back in my chair and I asked them what they were giggling about. And Hannah goes, "Well, now it's your turn, Dad." I said, "Okay." And so she went and she ran and she got this list. And so they made me a list of Bible questions that they were going to see if I could answer. And so, you know, my oldest daughter's 7. And then my middle daughter's 5. Of course, my youngest daughter, she's 1. And that's why my wife's not able to be here. She's getting a little fussy. So a 7-year-old and a 5-year-old made a list of Bible questions for me to answer. And so I'm leaning back in my chair and I'm thinking, I'm a preacher, right? They're 7 and 5 years old. Of course I got all these questions. All right, here we go. First one out the gate. How many commandments are in the Old Testament? Yeah, I got humbled really quickly. All right. Did Herod the Great have kids? What disciple betrayed Jesus? Now, I got that one. I got that one right. Name me all the disciples. I had to think about that one. I think I got them right. I don't know. I don't know if she knew them either, so she couldn't really judge me on that one. Who asked Jesus when to stop forgiving? That'd be Peter. I got that one. Did Jesus ever get stoned? Pretty good question, right? And then she gave me a true or false story, and this one cracked me up. She goes, "Dad, this next one's it's true or false, okay?" She said, "There's some things in it that's wrong, and you got to find the things that are wrong." I said, "Okay." And she holds this note up. She goes, "Zacchaeus. There was a man named Zacchaeus. He was very big, and he was very good, and he climbed a pecan tree to see Paul." I could spot that one. I figured out that one. And then the last question on the list, is there an ostrich in the Bible? And I just flat out have no idea. I'm sorry. So I had to Google that one up later. All right. Proud father moment. They were testing me. They were trying to trip me up. And I got to admit, they did kind of trip me up a little bit. But what I want to do is I want to talk about Jesus Christ being them trying to test him and trip him up. And so as we work our way through the last week of Christ, we find ourselves on Tuesday, which is a day of teaching. For those of you that are visiting, what we've been going through is the last week of Christ and every single day and what Jesus would do each and every one of those days leading up to his betrayal, arrest, crucifixion, and then resurrection. Now what we've looked at so far was beginning with Sunday, which was a day of triumph. That's because on the Sunday that was before the crucifixion of Christ, that was the day of the triumphal entry. And Jesus had come back to Jerusalem and they had this victory procession, if you will, going up to the temple. Jesus walks in the temple after the triumphal entry, a quasi-coronation of a king, if you will. And he comes into the temple, takes one look around, and he leaves, and he goes back to Bethany. Well, then on Monday, he comes back to the temple, and we talked about this last week. And what they thought was the first act as him being king, I'm sure that as he walked in the temple, they thought to themselves, "Oh, the Roman guards are over there. Go get them. They thought, he's the king that's going to set them free from the Romans, right? And Jesus said, no, I've got a problem with you. And so he would cleanse the temple. Many of us remember that story. He would drive out those who were buying and selling in the temple, and he turned over the tables of the money changers and stopped those from just traveling through the temple. That happened on a Monday. And then Tuesday, the day after, Jesus would come back to the temple, and it was a day of teaching. If you got your Bibles with you, go ahead and open up to Matthew chapter 21. Matthew chapter 21. And that's where we're going to stay in for the majority of the lesson this morning. Matthew chapter 21. If you look there, Matthew chapter 21 and verse 23, his day on Tuesday begins with his authority being challenged. Matthew 21, 23 says this, "When he come into the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him, and he was teaching and said, 'By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority?'" Does anybody recognize that verse? Do you know that that verse was the day after he cleaned the temple? And so he would walk into the temple on a Monday, clean house, make this huge commotion, a huge deal. By the way, that he did that during the Passover festival. And so that made it an even bigger deal. And that's why when he came back the day after, the chief priests and the elders walked up to him and said, by what authority do you do these things? Who gave you the authority to do this? Well, little did they know, they were dealing with the one who was actual God in the flesh. Colossians chapter 1, 16 and 17 says, "For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, thrones, dominions, rulers, authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He's before all things, and in him all things hold together." And you see, the people that were walking up to Jesus saying, "By what authority do you do these things?" They were asking that to the same man, the same being who had created them all the way back to Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1. And that's how the day began. The day began with the chief priests and the elders walking up saying, "What authority do you do this?" And Jesus would use that as a time to teach. By the way, that's a great principle in the life of a Christian, by the way. Especially in the life of an evangelist. Use opportunities that come to you, people being offended maybe. People just simply asking a question. People just wondering something that's different about you. Whatever it may be, use this as an opportunity to teach. And you see, there's a lot of people that are offended at the church. That's a big group. Use their offense with you as an opportunity to teach. Why? That's because what our Lord did. And on Tuesday, before he would be crucified, he would teach basically in 360 degrees all around him. But notice who he starts with right here. He starts with the chief priests and the elders. The ones who walked up to him and said, "By what authority do you do this?" And notice how he taught them. He would teach them, and you're more than welcome to skim through the section of the text. And by the way, I'm taking about 12 sermons worth of material and packing it down into one sermon. And I'm trying to do that all on a Sunday morning, so y'all are just going to have to bear with me. If your hair is blowed back, I apologize. Not really. He taught three different parables. He would teach in the parable of the two sons, verses 28 through 32, the parable of the tenants, and then the parable of the wedding feast. And so the chief priests and the elders came up. They said, "By what authority do you do these things?" And he would answer them in these three parables. Each one of these parables has to do with the covenant being initially with the Israelite people, but that it being taken from them and given to the world. Each one of these parables, the parable of the two sons, the parable of the tenants, and the parable of the wedding feast. And my favorite of those three is the parable of the wedding feast. Matthew 22, 1 through 14. That's when Jesus would tell of the kingdom of heaven is like a great wedding feast. And he said that the wedding feast was set and the table was set. And he said, "Go and tell all of my servants to come, for the feast is ready." And he would send some out to go and invite to the wedding feast. And the ones that got sent out were abused and beaten. And eventually he said, "Fine, go out into the streets and invite everybody. For those who beat my servants, who beat my slaves, they will never taste of my dinner." You see, the dinner was heaven. And so Jesus teaching these three parables to the chief priests and the elders was him teaching them that their covenant was going to be taken from them and given to the world. And that's what we have in the new covenant. So he would teach to the chief priests and the elders. But I want you to notice, and I forgot to mention this before we move on, in verse 23, the chief priests and elders, their attitude at the very beginning was that of just simply challenging his authority. They began that day with a question, didn't they? "By what authority do you do these things?" I want you to keep that in the back of your mind, because we're going to see their attitude at the end of the day. Notice secondly, that after Jesus would teach the chief priests and elders, that now the Pharisees step up. And so the chief priests and elders went away, and they thought, man, we couldn't trip him up. Couldn't catch him. And the Pharisees are over there looking from the side going, oh, well, now it's our turn. Let's go give him a try. And so the Pharisees would step up. And you can look there in chapter 22, verses 15 through 17. They would have a question concerning a tax. Let's read that together. Matthew chapter 22, 15 through 17. He says, then the Pharisees went and counseled together. By the way, they went and counseled. They kind of huddled up, right? And they said, let's figure out a way to get him, how they might trap him in what he said. Verse 16, they sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians, saying, teacher, we know that you are truthful and teach the way of God in truth, and defer to no one, for you are not partial to any. They were just buttering him up. Do you think they really believe that? Of course not. Verse 17, tell us therefore, what do you think? Is it lawful to give a poll tax to Caesar or not? Now, I want you to catch something. Did y'all catch who they took with them? The Pharisees went to Jesus, but who did they take with them? Look at verse 16 there. Along with who? The Herodians. The Herodians. By the way, you see religious division there. It's something God is never happy with. But notice who the Herodians were. The Pharisees believed that the poll tax was sacrilegious. So the Pharisees believed that if you were a good Jew and you paid the poll tax, that you were basically no longer a good Jew and standing in a good right standing with God. That's what the Pharisees believed. The Herodians, who were the actual literal enemies of the Pharisees, believed the opposite. They believed that all Jews should submit to the authority of Rome. The Pharisees and the Herodians hated each other with a vile passion, about like Republicans and Democrats. That's kind of who you're dealing with. The Pharisees and the Herodians hated each other, and yet they kind of put their hatred aside for just a second, just to see if they could trip up Jesus. By the way, they didn't care about the poll tax. They could care less. They were not legitimately concerned if God wanted them to or not to pay the poll tax. They could care less. All they wanted to do was just try to trip up Jesus, to test his authority. That's all they cared about. But notice Jesus' response. By the way, I love it. He calls them hypocrites. Why are you testing me, you hypocrites? That's why they're hypocrites, is because they weren't really believing what they were trying to test him and catch him in. But notice his response. His response was absolutely perfect. Matthew 22 and 21. They said to him, after he asked them, whose likeness is this on the coin? And they said to him, Caesar's. Then he said to him, then render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And it says there, and hearing this, they marveled, and leaving him, they went away. What an amazing answer, by the way. And that should be the attitude every Christian should have towards politics. Should we care about an upcoming election? You betcha. Vote like a Christian would vote. But should we care more about elections and politics and Democrats versus Republicans than we do God and the Word of God and the church he literally died for? Of course not. And yet, sadly, that's the case with a lot of Christians. And so the Pharisees, it says there in verse 22 that hearing this, they marveled, and leaving him, they went away. Now it's the Sadducees' turn. And the Sadducees step up and they say to themselves, the Pharisees couldn't get him. Now let's see if we can get him. By the way, that's the third religious group that were, if you're counting, Pharisee, Herodian, and Sadducee. Look at verse 23 there of Matthew 22. It says, on that day some Sadducees who say there is no resurrection came to him and questioning him, saying, verse 24, teacher, Moses said, if a man dies having no children, his brother, his next of kin, shall marry his wife and raise up an offspring to his brother. Now there were seven brothers with us, and the first married and died, and having no offspring, left his wife to his brother. So also the second, and the third, down to the seventh. And last of all, the woman died.
In the resurrection, therefore, whose wife of the seven shall she be? For they all had her. By the way, what absolute hypocrisy. They don't even believe in the resurrection. And they're asking Jesus about the resurrection. They could care less about his answer. They were just trying to trip him up. That's all they cared about. They just simply wanted to test his authority. But notice Jesus' answer. It was absolutely perfect.
He would go on to say there in verse 32, he says, I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living. Angels do not marry, as Jesus would say. You are misunderstanding, not understanding the scriptures or the power of God. For in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven. But regarding the resurrection of the dead, have you not read that which was spoken to you by God? Jesus' answer was perfect because he quoted scripture. And the Sadducees had nothing to say. Look at verse 33. It says, when the multitudes heard this, they were astonished at his teachings. All right. So the chief priests and the elders had their go at him. And he stomped them and they went away. Then the Pharisees had their go at him. And he stomped them and they went away. And the Sadducees stepped up and they had their chance. And they were stumped and went away. Now the Pharisees send another person out to him. But this time he's not just a Pharisee, but he's also a lawyer. Look there beginning in verse 34. It says, when the Pharisees heard that he had put the Sadducees to silence, they gathered themselves together. One of them, a lawyer, asking him a question, testing him, teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Everybody ought to know the answer to that one. You shall love God. What's the greatest commandment? Love God. That's it. That is about as simple and cut and dry as it gets. Why? Because if you love God, you're just going to do everything else underneath that umbrella of love. You say you love your wife, what do you do for her? Clean the house every now and then? Men, it's Father's Day. Do the dishes for your wife every now and then? Take care of your wife. Provide for your wife. Why? Because you love her. What do you do when you love God? You just naturally love his church, right? Love the brotherhood, as Peter would say. How do you show your love for God? By the way, who knew that the greatest commandment was issued by Jesus Christ on the Tuesday before he would go to the cross? Isn't that interesting? I love this day, this Tuesday, this day of teaching before he would go to the cross, because so many would question the authority of Christ, and we have so many beautiful aspects of the teachings of Christ because of the questions that they would ask him. And so, again, Jesus' answer was perfect. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and foremost commandment. He's quoting from Deuteronomy chapter 6 in verse 5. And so after that, Jesus kind of had enough. Hey, the chief priests and the elders, they stepped up and they questioned his authority. Well, then he stumped them. They went away. Then the Pharisees stepped up, questioned his authority. They went away. The Sadducees stepped up, questioned his authority, and they went away. Now this Pharisee lawyer steps up, questions his authority. Now he goes away. And it's almost as if Jesus said, that's enough. And then look at chapter 23. This is the famous chapter where Jesus Christ would issue seven woes to the scribes and Pharisees. Notice there, as you skim down with me, woe to you, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites, verse 13. Verse 14, woe to you, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites, and on and on and on. He would go down the list. By the way, in this section of Scripture, Jesus Christ would use some pretty harsh words, wouldn't he? I don't know about you, but I would not want my Lord and Savior to call me a brood of viper, or a serpent, or a whitewashed tomb, or a fool, or a blind guide, or a son of hell. You see, Jesus Christ spoke lovingly most of the time. You know, the words that would come out of his mouth, and you can read the pages, and you can just see the compassion and the grace that Jesus Christ would have. Think about the woman by the well in John chapter 4.
John chapter 4, the woman would come up to the well, and a woman that was just steeped in adultery. Did Jesus call her any of these things? And yet he turns around and does that to the Pharisees, the scribes, the hypocrites. You see, our Lord knew the hearts of men. And he knew who to say to who for the same result, to try to win the soul and to try to encourage repentance. That Jesus had the same desire for both occasions, but he handled them completely differently. By the way, I'm making a point of that because I want that to be a point of application that sticks with everybody. Not every single conversation we have with somebody who may be outside of the church or may be caught up in sin needs to be the same. If you take the same Bible beaten over the head approach to every single person, there's going to be some squirrels that you're going to chase away. You can't get that little squirrel to come up into your hand and eat out of your hand by yelling at it. But then at the same time, there are some people that you can do that with. I'll give you an example. Me and my little brother have a very close relationship together. You better believe if my little brother calls me up someday and says, "You know, Justin, I'm thinking about leaving my wife for this other woman." You better believe he better buckle up for the chewing of a lifetime, because I know I can do that with my little brother, with the result being what I desire it to be, and that is that of repentance and staying in the Word of God. And so we see Jesus here in Matthew chapter 23, almost as if he's just done with being tested. And he looks around and he issues these seven woes to these scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites, he calls them. Calls them sons of hell, blind guys, fools, whitewashed tombs, serpents, and broods of vipers. And then he just walks out of the temple. Don't you just love that? Don't you love that? He would teach in 360 degrees every single person that would come up to him. And then finally he would issue those seven woes, and then he just walks out of the temple. Look at Matthew chapter 24 and verse 1. It says, Jesus came out from the temple and was going away with his disciples. Now, Jesus would take this opportunity to teach his disciples. All right, so get the scene in your mind, okay? What would you say? I'll give you a multiple choice question here, like my little girls tried to give me a true or false question, okay? I'll give you a multiple choice question. Do you think Jesus is calm, cool, and relaxed? Or do you think Jesus is a little worked up and a little on fire at this point? What do you think? I'd say he's a little worked up, don't you? Notice, you got to love his disciples, by the way. You got to love them. Sometimes they're just kind of a little dense. Coming out of the temple, notice what it says. They say in verse 1, Jesus coming out of the temple and was going away when his disciples came up to point out the temple buildings to him. Mark would put it this way in Mark's account, chapter 13 and verse 1. As they were coming out, the disciples said, Teacher, behold what wonderful stones and what wonderful buildings. If there was ever a time for their disciples to maybe keep your mouth shut, it would have been now, wouldn't it? Jesus had just gone into the temple on Sunday for the triumphal entry. By the way, he knew that the same crowd that was crying out, Hosanna, was going to cry out, Crucify, just a few days later. That was on Sunday. Monday, he comes back, cleanses the temple. Tuesday, the day after that, he comes back and teaches, and his authority's just, I mean, they're just throwing everything to God at him, testing his authority, and Jesus, he has enough. How about that? Well, that thing came off of there pretty easy, didn't it? He had enough. And so he issues those seven woes to them. And then coming out of the temple, they have the audacity to say, look what beautiful buildings. Could you just imagine the look as Jesus just turned around and looked at them? I bet they melted in their spot. And that's why Jesus said, notice the response from our Lord right here. In verse 2, do you not see all these things? Truly I say to you, not one stone here shall be left upon another, which will not be torn down. Notice verse 3. This prompted a concern with the disciples. Verse 3, as he was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately. By the way, the Mount of Olives is just east of the temple, outside of Jerusalem by just a few miles. The disciples came to him privately saying, notice the questions. Tell us, when will these things be?
the things that Jesus just said, the destruction of the temple, and what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age. You see, the disciples just assumed that the temple was going to be there forever. And so when Jesus told them, don't you understand that the temple is going to be destroyed? In their mind, they're thinking, well, that's the end of the world. And so they asked him the question. In their mind, they asked one question. They said, tell us of these things and when the end of the age will be. But really, they asked two. Tell us of these things, the destruction of the temple. And second question was, and the coming of the Son of Man and the end of the age. And so Jesus would take that opportunity to teach, just like all the other opportunities he took to teach his disciples to be ready. For the first question was for the destruction of the temple, laid out in verses 4 through 35. And by the way, this right here is misunderstood by so many. There's a lot of people today that say that verses 4 through 35 here are talking about the end of the world, and these are the signs of the end of the world. You see people on TV saying the signs of the end of the world are coming. You know what they're referencing? They're referencing Matthew 24, 4 through 35. But I want everybody to look in your Bibles with me. Look at verse 36. You see, verses 4 through 35, Jesus was answering their first question, when's the destruction of the temple? And in verse 36, he pivots and says, but of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven or the Son of Man, but the Father alone. And from there on, he would talk about the judgment day and prepare them with two parables. The parable of the 10 virgins, meaning keep your lamp lit, be ready. And the parable of the talents, use what God has given you, for you know not when the master returns. So Tuesday was a day of teaching with the final thought on the teaching of Jesus being that of the judgment scene. And him describing the sheep going to the right and the goats to the left. And that is how the day would conclude on Tuesday. But I want you to notice something. As Jesus would teach, and I mean, he taught everybody around him. He used the occasion of him cleansing and really destroying the temple, the inside of it, cleansing that temple. He used that as an opportunity to teach. He had their attention, and now he's going to teach them. And he taught the chief priests and the elders. He taught the Pharisees. He taught the Sadducees. He taught a Pharisee lawyer. Then he issued woes to them. And then coming out of the temple, he teaches his disciples. But I want you to notice how the day ended. Remember how the day began? It began with a question. The chief priests and the elders just said, by what authority do you do these things? Notice how it ends. This is the end of the day, on Tuesday, before he'd be betrayed. Matthew 26, 3 through 5. Then the chief priest and the elders of the people gathered in the palace of the high priest. By the way, what's a high priest doing with a palace? Shows the corruption of the priesthood, doesn't it? The chief priest and the elders of the people gathered in their lofty mansion of a palace of the high priest, whose name was Caiaphas, and plotted together in order to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. But they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar among the people. So the day began with them just simply questioning, by what authority do you do these things? And at the end of the day, they wanted to kill him. It wasn't the cleansing of the temple that got him wanting to plot his death, was it? It was teaching truth. A lot of the things that Jesus would teach are hard for people to hear. And it was the teaching of that truth that would get Jesus betrayed and arrested and crucified on the cross. And that all happened on Tuesday, 2 days before Jesus would be betrayed with that kiss on a Thursday, which was a day of teaching. By the way, Jesus Christ would teach many, many things. Jesus Christ throughout his ministry would teach on just about every single topic and category that you could possibly think of, including salvation. And we see on that Tuesday that they challenged every single thing that he said. Everything Jesus would ever say, they challenged it. And then this group of people would challenge him, and then this group of people would challenge him. And people still to this day challenge the authority and the words of Christ. I'll give you an example right here. John chapter 3 and verse 5. Jesus answered. Who answered? Jesus did. What did he say?
Truly, truly. By the way, those two words in the original Greek language is the same word for amen. Amen, amen. I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Jesus Christ would teach on that, and still to this day some challenge his authority. Let me encourage everybody here. If there is somebody here who has not been baptized, do not challenge the authority of your Lord and Savior anymore. Just do it. He wants you to be baptized. Can you not see that he wants you to? If anybody has any need this morning, if you feel like you need to obey the teachings of Christ, please come forward now as we stand and as we sing.
All to Jesus I surrender. Thank you.